Naka Goodie Bee.
Because it is the evening, is that right? Yeah. In Wolof?
Yeah.
So greetings, let's say greetings in Wolof to the BlaXit family. So say it in Wolof. I'm going to introduce Lamin, who's here with us. Yeah. Lamin is from Gambia, and we're going to be talking about a very hot topic today. For the BlaXit family, today is going to be a really controversial vlog, and what we're going to do is try to stick to subjects within the few minutes that we've got. And basically, I'd like to welcome Lamin and Adrian back by public demand. We had so many comments and so many wonderful emails asking him to talk more, saying how he's intelligent, well spoken, and he gets to the point. He doesn't rabble like me. So, Lamin is a soldier here, and we're going to be talking about a hot topic. It is kicking off in England. What's that got to do with the diaspora? What's that got to do with Africa, you're asking me? It is kicking off. Why is it kicking off? Because reparations time is here. Family, BlaXit family, reparations time is here. Guess what? On a primetime TV show, a well-known poet, laureate, and professor, Benjamin Zephaniah, a man who I had the pleasure of meeting when I was very young, who gave me the opportunity to go on stage and do poetry, and he actually paid me, and that was at the Theatre Royal in Stratford, London. Now, he went on to primetime television, and he made a heartfelt and impassioned appeal that, you know, touched my heart and many others. And I will show you a clip of it so you can see what I'm talking about.
Crime, it was a very bad crime. It went on for a long time, and we are still feeling the effects of it.
Mm.
And we have to, I don't think there's one way of paying back. A people who, I mean, we've come from all different parts of Africa, and we don't even know. I just know that my parents came from somewhere, my great-great-great-grandparents came from somewhere in West Africa. But it's the thing with the slavery, and I only know about British slavery because that's what I'm a subject of. You took away my language, you took away my name, mm-hmm. you took away my culture. Took it away. It's not like I'm Indian, I still speak Hindi. I don't know what my language is, man. Mm. You know, how can you pay me back for that with money?
Well,
so it's deeper than this. But so when we start moving in one direction, that's a good thing. How we sort it out, I don't have all the answers, but at least we can start thinking about the big institutions. There's individuals, but at least we can start thinking.
He's talking about slavery, and he's talking about the fact of British slavery. And he made it, as you can see, abundantly clear that they took away our names, they took away our culture, they took away our language, they took away our resources, they took away our land, they took away our people, they took away our chance at the same future as what they've had, to be on the same level playing field. And it's not fair. And we want reparations. So that's what it's about. I don't know where I come from in Africa. I just know that my soul felt connected here in Gambia. And that's why we're here. But I couldn't tell you where I'm from. So I want Adrian and Lamin and myself to discuss this subject of reparations. I want to know what we're going to do. It's time for Africa to unite and to come together. And we must claim back our relics. We must claim back everything that they've taken. All of our artifacts. Everything has to come back. There are these global institutions that have made money and masses of wealth that is still there within their families for generation upon generation. Now, what are we going to do about it? On the 1st of August in England, there was a huge march, and I think it was for the sixth year, and we were very much involved in the marketing of it when we were in London, and we were making sure that it hit the news, and it was on Channel 4 News, and it was on London Live, and it was on the front cover of the Standard. Now, we don't know where we're from, but we know where we want to come back to, and that's the motherland. So over to you, Adrian, and over to you, Lamin. You know, what are your thoughts about reparations and what should we do now?
First of all, I want to thank everyone and greet everyone in our Gambian language. That is to say, Nangadef, Nakangonzi. Hope everybody is good. Yeah, like what our beautiful sister is talking about, is definitely is an issue at the moment. And actually, this is what we need to try to look for. That is for us to get back home, because there's no place like home, which I really understand. So I want everyone to do the way my sister do, just to pack whatever you have and get back home. You know, and we see how best we can do for our own people. Yeah, first of all, I want to thank everyone. Yeah.
Thank you so much. Adrian, what are your views on what, you know, Benjamin, Seth and I said? Because obviously I was born in England, you was born in the Caribbean, we are Africans born in the Caribbean, and I'm an African born in England, and you're an African born in Africa. So what is your take on this whole subject?
I think, hello listeners, I'm back again, you know, as my wife said, I'm a man of a few words, but today I will start of going a bit deeper into some of the stuff that we discuss on a daily basis. Benjamin Zephaniah is a well-educated poet. That's what he does in England, yeah? So he's well-respected, you know? And his words touch the heart of a lot of us as black people, because what he's saying is the absolute truth, especially for us in the diaspora, you know? I mean, for Lamin and these guys, they're the same as us,
yeah.
But there's still not a culture.
Yeah,
there's still not a language.
Yeah.
You know, but for us, that was taken away from us. Mm-hmm. Was taken away from us, you know? So now what Benjamin Zephaniah is trying to ask them, how are you gonna repair us for this damage that you've done to us, we the people in the diaspora? And every time we sort of bring this to the forefront, all we keep getting is backlash. Mm-hmm. Or it happened in the past. So why don't we learn from the mistakes that make and move on? Well, guess what?
Yeah.
We need to be repaired.
Definitely.
Yeah? Yeah? We need to be repaired. And the West has to play a part in our reparations and in the repairing of us. So now, when you look at Africa, when they came to Africa, what they have done, they've taken out the most precious jewel.
Yeah.
Forget about the gold and the diamonds. We the people. The intelligence, the brain box of Africa is what they take out to go and build the West. Yeah? Along with now they stole all the jewelries, but we were the most important thing that they came for. And their reason for doing that are because they never had the skills and intelligence to build the city that they want to build, that they're now trying to praise up as, oh, they're the first world country and we are the third world country. We are not the third world country, you know? Africa is still the most civilized continent on the planet, you know? So what we are saying about reparations, why it's so important, is that England, Europe, America, all those big institutes that actually benefit from slavery and still benefiting today from the slave trade, they need to go into their pockets and they need to start doing some repairs here in Africa, help build back infrastructures. When we speak about reparation, the individual white people start taking it personal. You know, it's like, we're not coming for you. We're coming for the institute that give you the privileges that you be sharing today in those cities. Yeah, and that is why they do get offended, because they know when they start giving back reparations, it will now damage the little privilege that they have. Yeah?
Exactly.
So that's why white people, what they do, they protect the little white privilege. They don't really care about you. They don't care about humanity. So the message I got from my brothers and sisters, yeah, please understand, it's not only us that got taken out as enslaved Africans that suffer. Africa suffer.
Yeah.
And how do Africa suffer? Because they take the manpower from Africa.
Yeah.
The manpower that should have here building Africa.
Yeah.
They take away the manpower and take the manpower to build the West free of cost. Free of cost. Even though they lied to us and said to us there was a deal between Africa and the West, Apart from this, they can't produce no contracts between them and Africa for the manslaughter, the evil, the brutality that they've done to our people. They have nothing to prove that Africa actually gave them a contract in this brutal, you know, in this inhumane treatment that they've done to us as a people. You see? So I want everyone, every one of us, brothers and sisters, you have a story to tell. You know? And every one of us have a right to fight for our reparations. Yeah? Because we need repairing. You understand? And part of the repairing we need again to learn. Trust in each other, because we have lost that. You know, and we have a big gap between Africa and the Caribbean. We need to bridge this. You know, and not to keep dividing us, because in another day we start working together. As you see, the Ghanaian president went to
Jamaica. To be Andrew Holness.
He's now trying to bridge this gap. Then when we bridge this gap, right, it's going to be a problem for them. So that is why they're doing the best to keep us divided. And to my brothers and sisters that leave Africa, you know, you leave Africa, you go to Europe, you say you're going for a better life.
Yeah.
You know, I can't tell you all what you've done is the wrong thing, but what I don't want you all to do is go to Europe and then disrespect the motherland. Yeah? Because those people that you think you're getting a better life with is the problem. Why the motherland is where it is today. They're the one that create this problem. Yeah. Right? I'm not going to go into too much, but we know they're the ones that create this. You understand? So what I would say to our brothers and sisters, when you go to the West, if you're going here to make money, think about your home first.
Yeah, very important.
Yeah? Because you have the Chinese here in Africa making money.
Yes.
And they're thinking about China. That this money they're making here is going to China.
Of course, yeah.
The Indian man, going to China. Yeah?
Lebanese.
Exactly.
Going
but,
to their
but country. Not only that, I think there's another element I'm going to just interlude, because colonial payments are still imposed on African nations today. You know, I think Senegal, of course, we're surrounded by Senegal, and Senegal has to pay something like 50 million every year. Now, if not, they impose sanctions on these countries. Remember that it's France that is printing the CEPA. So France is printing the currency for Senegal. So, you know, this whole situation needs to be untangled. This is unfair. The genocide that we went through, you know, it has to be addressed. Prince Charles went to Ghana, and while he was there, he talked about the heinous role that Britain played and the most painful chapter of Ghana's historic relations with Europe. He called it an appalling atrocity. That's what he said in his landmark speech. What I want to know is, when are the royal family going to pay up? Because I did an interview with Dr. Umar Johnson. You'll see a clip after this, when he talks about the royal family's involvement in the slave trade and how they have to pay up. So what I'm saying is that all of these large corporations, banks, sugar companies,
all of them, insurance companies.
Yeah. We shouldn't have to repatriate here without having a compensation package. Yeah. There should be an exodus package for us. People should be able to transfer their benefits if they have them, if they are from the diaspora, and come here and have the choice to live here, have the choice to come and rebuild this nation. How many times have we asked to speak to the government in England and it has landed on deaf ears? I have been on Sky TV, the news, and said the same thing. How is it that we as people born in England, paying taxes in England, and the colonies, let's not forget the empire and the colonies, the British colonies, have been paying taxes since 1833 up until 2015
yeah.
to pay compensation, for the loan that they took to repay the slave owners, the compensation they paid the slave owners, the people that raped, pillaged, murdered, sodomized, abused our children, cut our women in half, pulled our men with their arms tied to horses, chopped our arms and legs off and our limbs, fed our babies to alligators and crocodiles, raped our women, sodomized our men, made mothers sleep with their sons with brown bags on their heads.
Mm-hmm.
When are they going to pay? It's time for payback. People say to me, oh, reparations isn't about money. You know what? Some of the things they took, we can't get back. We can't atone for. There is no restitution.
We need the repairs.
But what we need in order to make sure that we can put things right. And that takes money, that takes the return of resources.
Yeah.
That means that there needs to start a dialogue. The dialogue needs to start, and then you know what? Cash needs to flow. Things need to be gotten back, and I want all of our things back. In all of those museums, we need our stuff back. You stole them. If I stole this phone from you, right? If I steal your phone, Adrian.
It remains your property until it comes back. It's still your property.
Is this my phone?
It's not your phone. It's always going to be my property. So it doesn't matter where they take it.
Yeah.
This phone's still going to be my property. Yeah, because it was stolen. But I just want, if there's any good lawyers listening to this, you know, I want themselves have a role to play. They understand the law a bit more than us. Because what is really insulting about all of this is that the slave owners, they got paid out while we got left out.
Yeah?
Exactly.
So we have to understand that. They paid them out, and as my wife just said, the last payment that the British government made back from the money they borrowed from the treasury to pay the slave owners was paid back. Was paid back in 2015.
By
and
us.
I think it took them 182 years for them to make that payment.
The 40 million. But yeah. It was paid back by us. Why should we be paying
so
back?
So this is why I want to speak to any intelligent lawyers there. Because we should be able to claim back that tax.
I want a refund.
Yeah, we need a refund. We need to set up a compensation scheme because we need to get that money back. You know? Because we shouldn't have to pay for our enslavement. Yeah? And to say our so-called freedom from the enslavement. Yeah? So that's what I'm saying. They get paid out while we get left out. Yeah? And it's so nice. Yeah. It's so nice that now...
I think we've got someone joining the debate. Come on in.
I have someone very important person. Oh, sorry, dear. I'm really sorry.
Okay, so while he's opening the door, I'll continue the discussion. Now, this is probably going to have to take part in two parts. And I think one of the reasons why this has to be an ongoing debate is because it's such a huge subject. But I want to talk about the accepted forms of reparations. One of which is restitution. Restitution is almost like putting you back in the position that you would have been, had, you know, the atrocities not happened.
That's the second.
The second is compensation. Yeah. Come and join us. This is Dr. Sankung.
Yeah.
Dr. Sankung is
a very good
doctor
here in Gambia. This is our family doctor, you know?
Oh, wonderful. Thank you for joining us. This is Dr. Sankung, who has also travelled within the diaspora. And he's come back home. So we're just talking about reparations now because it's a hot topic right now in England. It is kicking off. On the 1st of August, they had the reparations march from Brixton all the way to Parliament. It's the sixth year. And now we're saying we've had enough of the government ignoring, our requests to make meetings in order to take things forward. You know, we've had enough of the nonsense. We've had enough of them ignoring us. It's time for them to open up, you know, the doors of negotiation with us.
Justice.
Yeah, and reparative justice. So we were talking about the different types of reparations. So there's restitution, there's compensation, there's rehabilitation, and there's a guarantee of non-repetition. Now, the guarantee of non-repetition is interesting because the whole dilemma of what is happening in West Papua now, including England's involvement, British Petroleum and other companies' involvement within the genocide is very questionable, knowing that slavery is still going on right now in 2019 in West Papua, and that the situation in West Papua has happened as a result, as a direct result of the UN agreement and also the way that they did not have access to the complete system of democracy, and they were forced against their will by Indonesia in order to be in the situation that they're in now. So we're just going to carry on talking about reparations. I'm going to invite Dr. Sankung to give us his take on what do you think we should do, and what do you think about the subject of reparations and rebuilding Africa? What do you think? Don't you think that we're owed this?
I also believe the same thing. I believe that reparation is something fair, something that should be considered, because Africans build Europe. So at the end of the day, they are marginalized, they are disadvantaged, and they don't have equal opportunity.
No.
They don't have equal opportunity. So for that being the case, I think reparation is quite okay to mend the wrongs that were done before. I think it's the right way to go.
Thank you so much. So can I ask, where have you been within the diaspora? Because you obviously talking from experience.
Yes, I've lived in America for a very long time. In fact, one of my kids is just going back to, on Sunday, back to America, and he's been here to be raised here because, I mean, it's really difficult to really raise kids over there. I mean, it's good for them to know their culture and all that. So basically, I've lived in America, North Carolina, New York, of course, a few states in America, but blacks are not really, really treated fairly. They're not treated fairly. There's no equal opportunity, and there's discrimination everywhere. And so I think reparation is the right thing to do.
Did you face any racism while you were in America?
Of course, yes. I mean, employment. I mean, you know, you can see, whites are normally paid more, of course, than black people. That's the truth. I mean, that's how it works. And of course, I mean, it's not sometimes done openly, but racism is like they do it under, you know.
It's indirect. It's like the unconscious bias. It's the microaggressions.
Exactly.
It's a subtlety. It's the way that you're not selected, and they always give you some form of reason, even though you were probably the best. But, you know, their unconscious bias is telling them that you're not as suitable as a candidate that looks like them.
Exactly.
Because in their own mind, they're discriminated against you because they think that you're less than them.
Exactly.
And this permeates their thinking.
Exactly.
And it's been shown in illicit bias tests. Illicit bias tests have shown that there is definitely proof that, you know, there's discrimination in decision making within recruitment, which is why they started to, you know, include that. But listen, we're going to have to wrap up, BlaXit family. We've kind of gone over time. This is not a 10-minute, even a 15-minute episode or vlog. And I want to say some shout outs to Woda Maya, who helped us to begin our journey, our BlaXit journey with our vlog. I also want to thank Jamil Potter. And also, I've got a little special one for Humphrey Smith, because he wrote to me in Jamaican patois and he gave us a very generous donation towards our equipment. And we got a camera and we're still trying to work out how to use it, so we're getting there. So, Mua said, thank you very much, my brother. Every little penny I've got put towards the project, all right? I mean, thank you, my brother, from the very bottom of my heart. So, yeah, without further much ado, to all of our family in Montserrat, in Jamaica, in England, all across Africa, Canada, New York, Peninsula, Atlanta, Kuwait, Somalia, where else have I missed? Italy, Sweden, Switzerland. These are people that I've heard from all over. I just want to thank you. I've got a couple shout outs that I want to give out to, but I'll do it in the next video. There's TV Africa I want to give a shout out to. People subscribe to their channel as well, because they're building. And there's another channel as well that I want to give a big shout out to, but to be honest with you, I didn't write down the name. So I will do next time though. But just suffice to say that BlaXit family, we are growing.
After most of our listeners, a lot of them mistaken my accent for Jamaican, but I'm Montserratian. So I'm from a smaller island in the Caribbean, right next to Antigua, the one with the volcano.
He's an African born in Montserrat.
So I'm an African born in Montserrat. As you know, if a lion never born in a crocodile pond, it still remains a lion. Yeah? It doesn't change your crocodile.
No.
So I'm an African. born in Montserrat, you know? So yeah, Montserrat is where I was raised. I lived there for 24 years, then I moved to England. Okay. You know, and then I'm now back to Africa.
Now you know why it's hard to end the videos.
Yeah. Alright, so see you all, yeah?
Thank you.
And we'll be back for more. Part two.
Part two. So, Dr. Sankung, thank you so much for joining us. So, this is Juliet, as you all know, hopefully, because I always forget to announce myself. But, you know, from the bottom of my heart, I just want to thank you for subscribing. Thank you for sharing. Oh, I've got good news. Sorry. We've got over 500,000 views on Facebook with Woden Meyer's video of where I talked about England being a dump and Africa being paradise. Woo, woo. So, keep sharing. Dr. Sankung, let's tell people what you do here and where they can reach you.
Well, I can be reached at Kotu by the fire service. We have a clinic there, and 723-7914 if you need drugs. We also, of course, have the pharmacy service, the Sunu drug store, and we hope to see you guys.
Okay, so what he means is he's a chemist. When he says drugs, yeah, he means medicine. Yeah,
medicine.
Yeah, before people think we're taking drugs, y'all. Yeah, medicine, I don't want to get twisted and kicked off of YouTube.
medicine.
So he's a doctor, if ever you need a GP here, he's the man to go to. Like he said, he's in Kotu by the fire station. Give me that number one more time slowly.
723-7914.
Brilliant.
Thank you.
So, I hear that lots of you are coming. I've been reading your emails, and I know you're coming to the Gambia, and I'm definitely going to hook up with you all. We are family, BlaXit family. So, we're going to do some trips. We're going to have a great time. And I'm patting my hair because Seth is always signaling his stuff to me. Seth, I want to thank you for being the cameraman today. Big yourself up. And you've got a lot of editing to do because we talk too much. Lamin, my mate man, is our soldier here. Is the defender of the country. The defender of the country.
Thank you everyone for your beautiful listening. Yes, and I thank my brother and his wife. And I thank the doctor also for being part of us here to give you our experience or our understandings on our knowledge about Africa here. So I thank you all. I will tell you bye-bye the next time. That is Wolof. Yeah?
Say it, Wolof.
The next time. Yeah, that is Wolof.
Yeah. Oh, no, Naka Bitch, no. Biscuit Cannon. Peace and love, BlaXit family. Yeah. Please remember to comment down below. We love them, we read them. And please subscribe if you haven't already. Yeah, share. And if Cafre was here, he will tell you to smash that like button. So I'm going to try and grab him and see if I can edit it in at the end, because he loves doing that. And he loves all your comments about him being cute. He now thinks he's the most handsome boy in the world, which of course is true. So listen, see you next time, and thank you. And I haven't forgotten your shout outs to anyone I didn't mention. I'm coming back with them on the other side. All right.
Bye.
Peace,
bye.
Love, bye. And BlaXit, Africa.
It's a discrimination, and if you like, neo-Nazi groups have now risen in this country. What's your view on reparations, repatriation, and what advice would you give to Africans in
return? Firstly, I would say that repatriation is a form of self-inflicted reparations. Repatriation is something we need to do to help heal the wounds within. Let's be clear. We are entitled to reparations. We will get reparations. But reparations won't solve black-on-black hate. Reparations won't solve the lack of trust. Reparations won't make the black woman love the black man, and it won't make the black man love the black woman. So although we need those financial reparations and resources, we recognize that most of the repairing that has to be done in-house, in the community, without any money. Most of the healing that we need doesn't cost a dime to do. It takes effort. But we do need the reparations because we need our own banks. We need our own warehouses. We need our own pharmacies, our hospitals, our farmland. We need our own schools. So we definitely need the reparations. But in order to get the reparations, African people in European context have to disidentify from being a black British. We have to disidentify from being a black Canadian. Then we have to disidentify from being a black American. As long as you are a subject of a nation, you cannot sue for reparations. Reparations are given to nations, nationalities, and groups of people who recognize themselves as separate, although they live within a larger oppressor nation. So there needs to be a change of identity in order for there to be true reparations. Now, let me say this. I have some concerns about reparations. I'm going to give you three. My first concern for reparations is I don't see all of the guilty parties named in the lawsuit. The Arab nations that participated in the Ma'afa, they have not been named. There's certain British entities, including the Queen of England herself, she has not been named as a guilty party in the reparations debt. And we know Britain colonized, what, 75% of the African world. So if there's anybody who owes reparations, it's right here, the Queen. So she has to be named as well. And there's a lot of other corporations that have yet to be named in the lawsuit. That's number one. Number two, I have yet to see anybody quantify the psychological cost of the Ma'afa. We see the calculations for unpaid labor. Understandable. But what about the calculations of the psychological, emotional, and spiritual damage done to African people, a cost that supersedes any unpaid labor our ancestors were not given on the cotton field? We must quantify the psychological cost of reparations. And number three, I hope we're not only asking for money. Because the American dollar isn't worth much, the British pound is worth more. But nonetheless, because the benefit of slavery will never expire to the UK, the benefit of slavery will never expire to the US or to France or to Portugal or to Belgium, because they can never lose the benefit of our dehumanization, we should never be able to lose the reparation that is paid to us for that suffering. So in other words, if they give us $1 trillion, one day that $1 trillion will run out. If they give you a multi-trillion dollars, one day that multi-trillion dollars will run out. So what we are asking for should be assets, resources, control of certain lands and waterways that never expire until the end of time. If we're asking for anything that expires with time, then that's a bad reparations request.
That includes South Africa right now.
Yes, indeed. And to the brothers and sisters in South Africa, we want them to continue struggling. We stand behind them. I'll be going to South Africa June 15th to speak on National Youth Day. I was trying to get the Queen Mother Winnie Mandela's homegoing ceremony. I might not be able to do that, but I will be in South Africa in June. We stand behind them. Here's one thing we need to understand. The European loves putting time limits on justice. As African people, we don't put no time limits on justice. The European loves talking about law and order. As African people, we don't give a damn about law and order until there is justice. Don't talk to me about laws and order until there is justice. And so with the European, they say, since slavery was a couple hundred years ago, we need not compensate for you. They say, since the South Africans stole that land, the white South Africans stole that land a couple hundred years ago, we have no just claim to take it back. What we need the European to understand is we do not believe in the concept of time-limited justice. If you did a wrong to me 5 million years ago, that is a wrong that still has to be paid. Absolutely. And I will treat that debt you owe me as if you just stole the land last night.
Yeah, yes. That's right. That's right.
Thank you.
You out?
Yeah, we're moving out, people.
Yeah.
Years living in the diaspora.
More than 500 years.
500 years we sit down by the rivers of Babylon.
My people,
500 years under oppression,
people,
with no solution. When I say repatriation, you say no. Repatriation,
no.
Reparation.
No.
When I say repatriation, you say no. Repatriation,
no.
Reparation.
No.
When I say repatriation, you say no. Repatriation,
no.
Reparation.
No.
When I say repatriation, you say no. Repatriation,
no.
Reparation.
No.
500 years of slavery.
Repatriation,
no. Reparation,
no.
Of which all are we is the legacy.
Repatriation,
no. Reparation,
no.
Pretend you don't know me, act as if you don't see.
Repatriation,
no. Reparation,
no.
This case ain't closed, tell me how do you plead.
Repatriation,
no. Reparation,
no.
Guilty of crimes against humanity.
Repatriation,
no.
Reparation,
no. Lost my heritage, lost my sanity.
community. Repatriation now, reparation now. The government need to apologize to it. Repatriation now, reparation now. Look like you wanna get away scot-free. Repatriation now, reparation now.
When I say repatriation, you say no. Repatriation,
no.
Reparation,
no.
When I say repatriation, you say no. Repatriation,
no.
Reparation,
no.
When I say repatriation, you say no. Repatriation,
no.
Reparation,
no.
When I say repatriation, you say no. Repatriation,
no.
Reparation,
no.
West Papua genocide is a crime by design.
Repatriation, no.
Reparation,
no.
Stop the amalgamese, this petition you must sign.
Repatriation,
no.
Reparation,
no. Help me to free me, my oppressor refuse to see me.
Repatriation,
no.
Reparation,
no. Nothing no change, you still wanna deceive me.
Repatriation, no.
Reparation,
no.
It wasn't my fault, so why you wanna blame me?
Repatriation,
no.
Reparation,
no. Deny your history and try to shame me.
Repatriation,
no.
Reparation,
no. It's high time you pay me so I can repair me.
Repatriation,
no.
Reparation,
no. Go to the mint and print and stop being a skin.
Repatriation,
no.
Reparation,
when
no.
I say repatriation, you say no.
Repatriation,
no.
Reparation,
no.
When I say repatriation, you say no.
Repatriation,
no.
Reparation,
no.
When I say repatriation, you say no.
Repatriation,
no.
Reparation,
no. When I say repatriation, you say no.
Repatriation,
no.
Reparation,
no. Yes, my people, remember the West Indies. Remember Shark Island. Remember Brazil, Africa, USA. Remember Australia, West Papua in Flint. Remember all the fallen and the innocent souls and spirits of our ancestors. All the sheroes and heroes. Benny Wender, Mark Smiley, Stephen Lawrence Gray, Trayvon, Sarah Reed, Malcolm X, Martin Luther King, Marcus Garvey, Harriet Tubman, John Oscar. Slave masters got paid out and we got left out. Big up to our organization, and remember, every August 1st, African Emancipation Day, Reparations March, London. African Emancipation Day, Reparation March, London. Every August. Repatriation, no!